After studying this module, you shall be able to know about Karen Horney's life, learn the path-breaking theories proposed by Horney, evaluate Horney's theory and treatment practices, analyze the relevance of the theory in present time. The psychoanalytic social theory of Karen Horney stressed social-cultural influences on personality development and neurosis. Horney insisted that modern competitive culture propagates overwhelming feelings of insecurity and exaggerated needs for love and affection. Normal person is capable of adjusting to hostile conditions and of making the best use of what the culture has to offer. The neurotic, in contrast, is unable to adjust and uses defenses rigidly and indiscriminately to listen his or her fears and to feel safe. Like traditional Freudian psychoanalysis, Horney firmly believed that the unconscious intrapsychic conflicts in the childhood are a powerful determinant of personality. However, she questioned Freud's emphasis on sexual conflicts. According to Horney, the most important conflicts are based on unresolved interpersonal issues, most of which can be traced to a lack of genuine love. Children who do not receive genuine affection experience basic anxiety and develop neurotic trends or rigid behavioral patterns to cope. Horney believed in inherent constructive forces made her much more optimistic than Freud about the possibilities of psychotherapy. For Horney, the goal of therapy was not to transform hysterical misery into everyday unhappiness, but to help people achieve the joy of self-realization. Horney is credited with founding feminist psychology in response to Freud's theory of penis envy. She disagreed with Freud about inherent differences in the psychology of men and women and argued that such differences can be traced to society and culture rather than anatomy. Although Horney's writings are concerned mostly with the neurotic personality, many of her ideas can also be applied to normal individuals. We shall try and look at Horney's basic theory of neurosis, briefly discussed her ideas on psychotherapy and examine her views on feminine psychology. Horney's psychological works: Basic Anxiety and Basic Hostility. Horney in 1950 believed that we begin our lives with the potential for healthy development but need favorable conditions such as warm and loving environment for feeling of safety and satisfaction and healthy growth. Unfortunately, a multitude of adverse influences may interfere with these favorable conditions. Primary among these is the parental indifference, that is, parents' inability or unwillingness to provide warmth, love, and affection to their children. This indifference is communicated by the parent through such things as direct or indirect dominance, lack of respect for child's need, lack of warmth, neglecting to fulfill promises, overindulgence or rejection, isolation from children of one's age group, preference for one child over another, making fun of child's thinking, blaming a child for what they have not done. Horney termed parental indifference as the basic evil as it threatens the child's sense of safety and security. The basic evil naturally instigates feeling of resentment and anger, a response called as basic hostility. However, children seldom overtly express this hostility as they are completely dependent on their parents for survival. Instead, they repress their hostility towards their parents. Repressed hostility then leads to overwhelming feelings of insecurity and a vague sense of apprehension. This condition is called basic anxiety, which Horney in 1950 defined as an instudiously increasing, all-pervading feeling of being lonely, and helpless in a hostile world. In Horney's world, we feel small, insignificant, helpless, deserted, endangered in a world that is out to abuse, cheat, attack, humiliate and betray. Just as Adler described inferiority as a childhood experience, Horney described anxiety, helplessness and vulnerability as natural childhood experiences. Basic anxiety is constant and unrelenting, permeates all relationship with others, motivates people to seek security and reassurance rather than happiness or pleasure, and leads to unhealthy ways of trying to cope with people. Neurotic needs. Horney is known for her study of neurotic personality. She defined neurosis as a maladaptive and counterproductive attempt to cope with feelings of insecurity, hostility and helplessness that accompany basic anxiety. She insisted that neuroticists use defensive strategies to compulsively protect themselves against basic anxiety, resulting in behaviors that perpetuate lower self-esteem, generalized hostility, inflated feelings of superiority, and constant apprehension that future aggravate basic anxiety. Since Horney's idea of neurosis involves dealing with the problem, she presented 10 needs that are acquired to find solution to combat basic anxiety. She called these 10 categories of needs neurotic since they are irrational, compulsive, rigid, and used indiscriminately to re-establish the safety of the environment. First is need for acceptance and affection. It includes the desire to be liked, to please others and meet others' expectations. Such individuals are very sensitive to criticism and fear the rejection and hostility of others. Second is the need for an intimate partner who will take over one's life. It includes the idea that love will untangle all the complex knots of our lives. A neurotic needs a partner to fall dependent on and let the partner take charge of the relationship. Third is need to restrict one's life with self-made boundaries. This involves being undemanding, satisfied with little, and need to be inconspicuous. It goes to the extreme that the neurotic does not want to see the world outside of his constricted view and struggles in new situations. Also, they make their own needs secondary and undervalue their own potential. Fourth is the need for power and control. It is the need for dominance for its own sake, often accompanied by contempt for the weak. Such individuals fear personal limitations, helplessness, and uncontrollable situations. Fifth is the need to manipulate and exploit others. Such individuals pride themselves in their ability to manipulate others for some desired objective like money, power, or sex. Sixth is the need for prestige and recognition. Such individuals are totally driven by the need to admire and respected by others. They evaluate all things, material possession, professional accomplishment, social engagement, loved ones, in terms of their prestige value. Such individuals fear loss of status and social embarrassment. Seventh is the need for personal admiration. Such individuals have an exaggerated self-perception and feel the need for admiration based on their imagined self-view rather than their own real self. They seek to be the best in whatever they do and be praised for that. Eighth is the need for personal accomplishment. Such people have indiscriminate ambition to be outstanding in many areas. They fear failures and generally overwork themselves to achieve their goal. Ninth is need for independence. They exhibit the loner mentality. They like to remain aloof in order to maintain their independence and personal autonomy over their lives. Tenth and the last one is need for perfection. They strive for complete infallibility. They try to be overcritical of themselves, to find the minutest flaw in themselves, to quickly cover it up or correct it. Horney noted that we all manifest these needs to some degree. But what makes them neurotic is the person's intensive or compulsive pursuit of their satisfaction as the only way to resolve basic anxiety. Further, these needs give birth to inner conflict within the individual and are insatiable, leaving the person always dissatisfied with how much one gets. Three solutions, neurotic trends. In her later writings, Horney in 1945 reformulated the list of needs and presented them in three groups, each indicating a person's behavior and attitude towards the self and others. She called these three categories of solutions to the stresses of life as the neurotic trends. Normal individuals may flexibly use any of these modes of relating to other people, but neurotics are compelled to behave in accordance with one of the neurotic trends. Displaying it indiscriminately, almost compulsively in any and all situations. Moving towards people, the self-efficacing solution, compliant personality. This represents a person striving to feel worthy but turning towards others. Horney referred to these people as the compliant types. Compliant types are dominant by a need for affection, living as though their motto were, "If you love me, you will not hurt me." They have an intense need to be liked, wanted, protected, and appreciated by others. As a result, they desperately employ methods to seek approval of others and tend to be self-efficacing, submissive, and compliant with the wishes of others. They avoid anything that might antagonize others because they fear criticism, rejection, or desertion by others. They tend to be dependent on others and often seek a powerful partner who will take responsibility of their lives. Moving away from people, the resignation solution, detached personality. This represents the person's attempt to attain autonomy by becoming asocial and emotionally detached. In their attempt to protect themselves from being hurt by other people, detached person renounce emotional needs and become almost indifferent to others. They frequently build a world of their own and need their own space and privacy. They value freedom and self-sufficiency and often appear to be aloof and unapproachable. They shun social commitments, but their greater fear is to need other people. They seem to live by the motto, "If I withdraw, nothing can hurt me." Moving against people, the expansive solution, aggressive personality. This represents a person's desire for control, dominance, and power. Such personality types come across as bossy, arrogant, defiant, selfish, vindictive, and even cruel. Horney argued that these people project their own hostilities, which she called externalization, onto others and therefore use this as a justification to exploit others and get the better of them. They seldom admit their mistakes and are driven to achieve control, recognition, superiority, and perfection. They seem to live by the motto, "If I have power, I will not be hurt." Career competitive people are often aggressive types. Self theory. Horney believed that the self is the core of our beings, our potential. A healthy person will have a clear sense of his self and would be free to realize his potential. Such self-realization is possible only with a strong self. A neurotic, on the other hand, views things in a different light. His self is split into the despised self and the ideal self. The ideal self is an unrealistic representation of perfectionism that seems impossible to attain. Neurotics believe that they should be perfect, know everything, like everyone. This belief presents itself as a compulsive drive, what Horney called as the trinity of shoulds, and the neurotic striving for glory. Unfortunately, self-idealization does not work, and actual self always falls short of the idealized self. This failure to reach the ideal self leads to resentment towards the present self or the despised self. As a result, neurotics are filled with self-hatred. They feel inferior, frustrated, and tormented, place resentment demands on the self, and engage in self-contempt, merciless self-accusation, and self-destructive actions and impulses. Self-analysis. Horney believes that a therapist must help patients gradually grow in the direction of self-realization. More specifically, she asserts that the aim of the therapy is to have patients abandon their idealized self-image, renounce their neurotic striving for glory, and change self-hatred to an acceptance of the real self. A therapist may begin with inquiries that provide clues to presence of the underlying conflict. These inquiries may generate anxiety and be a difficult and painful experience for the patient, but will eventually help them become aware of obstructive forces operating within them. Once the self-knowledge is experienced at an emotional level, the patient becomes unwilling to give up on the idealized images and illusions about self. The therapist then focuses on helping them find their real selves. Through free association and dream analysis, their real selves may begin to emerge. Patients are reinforced for any sign of greater independence in their thinking, of assuming responsibility for themselves, and of being interested in the truth about themselves. This encourages them towards greater self-realization and personal growth. Although a therapist can help encourage patients towards self-understanding, Horney believed the successful therapist is built on self-analysis. She suggested that people with relatively minor neurotic problems could be their own psychiatrist, emphasizing the personal role each person has in their own mental health. Self-analysis is a helpful tool for discovering the truth about one's own self. It involves free association followed by reflection of what one has thought and an analysis of resistance that aims to maintain status quo. When insights into one's personality are obtained, energy is engaged in perpetuating, neurotic trends are freed and used for making constructive changes. She stressed that self-awareness was a part of becoming a better, stronger, richer human being. Feminine psychology. As the first woman to present a paper on feminine psychology at an international meeting, Karen Horney pioneered and developed a feminine psychology that provided a new way of thinking about women. She thoroughly criticized Freud's account of feminine development and saw gender differences as a function of cultural and social factors and not anatomical or genetic influences. Horney argued that females have intrinsic biological constitutions and patterns of development that must be understood in their own terms and not just as products of their difference from males. She contended that psychoanalysis regards women as defective men because it is the product of men-dominated culture. Although Horney, 1939, recognized the existence of the Oedipus complex, she insisted that it wasn't universal, but culturally dependent. She held that it is found only in some people and is an expression of the neurotic need for love. A child may passionately cling to one parent and express jealousy towards the other, but these behaviors are means of alleviating basic anxiety and not manifestation of an anatomical based Oedipus complex. Horney found the concept of penis envy even less possible. She contended that there is no more reason for girls to be envious of the penis than for boys to be envious of the womb or the breasts. She developed the concept of womb envy, contended that boys desire pregnancy, childbirth, and motherhood, and men's impulse towards creative work is an overcompensation for their small role in procreation. Horney agreed with Adler that many women possess a masculine protest. That is, they have a pathological belief that men are superior to women. This belief, however, is not rooted in penis envy, but in resentment towards man for the status and recognition afforded to them by the culture. Such women desire to be a man and wish for all those qualities or privileges that are regarded as masculine. Evaluative comments, controversies, Horney's critique of Freud. Horney was a strong critic of Freud's theories and believed that strict adherence to Freudian psychoanalysis would lead to stagnation in theory and practice. She insisted that psychoanalysis should move beyond instinct theory and emphasize the importance of cultural influences in shaping personality. Horney agreed with Freud that our early childhood experiences shape our personality, but disagreed on his insistence on the centrality of the sexual drive in determining human personality. She placed greater importance to the role of cultural forces and our sense of security and safety in shaping our lives. Horney said that neuroses were an outgrowth of disturbed human relationship rather than compulsive rise. Further, Freud and Horney differ in their view towards human conflicts and their resolution. While Freud's view seemed pessimistic and stagnating, Horney had a more positive outlook and considered human's tendency towards personal growth as a lifelong process. Horney defended women against the charge that they were naturally masochist. Women dependent on men for love, money and security that led them to overemphasize beauty and charm. Women also seek meaning through their relationship with husband, children, family and friends. Kevin Horney viewed aggression not as inborn drive but as a means for human survival and security. Also, her view on narcissism was opposed to Freud. While Freud believed that narcissism was self-love or overindulgence in oneself, Horney stated it is as a lack of a sense of security. Criticism. Horney theory is often criticized for lack of empirical evidence and falls short on its ability to generate research and to submit its terms to fossilability. Her theory was based largely on clinical experiences that dealt primarily with neurotic individuals. She was reluctant to make specific assumptions about psychologically healthy individuals. Because her theory deals mostly with neurotics, it is rated highly on its ability to organize knowledge of neurotics, but very low on its capacity to explain about people in general. There is generally a lack of research on how her concepts apply to normal healthy personality. Skloos and Skloos criticize Horney for not making use of the research data from the areas of sociology and anthropology when talking about the impact of social and cultural forces on personality. Many felt that her observations and interpretations were influenced by the middle class American culture. It is said that Horney's personality theory is not as developed as Freud. Horney's attempt to redesign Freud's concept was widely criticized. Many thought that it would have been better if she rejected Freud's theory and developed her own. It is also said that much of her work were only an altered state of the theories of Freud, Jung and Adler. Contribution. Horney is best known as a critic of orthodox Freudian psychoanalysis and as a founding theorist of humanistic psychology. She not only refuted some of Freud's major theories but also attempted to move from biological determinism inherent in his theories to the importance of social, cultural and interpersonal factors in the formulation of personality. Horney's theory is somewhat more optimist than the traditional psychoanalysis. Horney believed that people possess inherent curative powers that lead them towards self-realization. If basic anxiety can be avoided, people will feel safe and secure in their interpersonal relation and consequently will develop enriching healthy personality. She argued that the underlying causes of neurosis and anxiety are the same for men and women and thus corrected what she saw as Freud's overemphasis on instinctual drives and his male bias in regard to feminine psychology. Many psychologists appreciate her work on devising concepts like neurotic trends, the need for safety, the role of anxiety, and the idealized self. Research also supports aspects of her theory, namely the neurotic trends, feminine psychology, etc. Summary: Karen Horney's theories on the psychology of women, her work on understanding and treating neuroses, and her ideas on the possibility of human growth influenced many people. She claimed that neurosis was a result of disturbed human relationships rather than compulsive drives. Horney described anxiety, helplessness, and vulnerability as natural childhood experiences. She presented 10 neurotic needs that are required to find solution to combat basic anxiety. Horney condensed the 10 neurotic needs into 3 solutions. Horney believed that a neurotic sense of self is split into the despised self and the ideal self. She devised her own tool of healing known as self-analysis. Karen Horney defected from the orthodox Freudian view to find a whole new school of thought by herself. Horney's theories were often criticized for lack of empirical evidence to support her theories. Many psychologists appreciate her work on feminine psychology and on devising concepts like neurotic trends, the need for safety, role of anxiety, and the idealized self.